Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to HaKadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Now we're continuing our journey through the story of the Bible, and today we pick up at the burning bush. Now, we have seen that Moses has been chosen by God at birth for a very special purpose. You'll remember that Abraham was told his people would be great and mighty, but they were going to go through a time of suffering and hardship. And so Moses is to be killed by Pharaoh along with all the males, and yet in the providence of God, Moses is raised in the very house of the one who wanted to kill him. What an amazing God we serve. Now, Moses' mother had instilled within him his heritage, his belief in Yahweh, that his forefathers were Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses, seeing the persecution of his people, defends them against the house of Pharaoh. And because it becomes known that he slayed an Egyptian, he now flees into the wilderness, into the desert, takes a wife, bears a son, and resigns himself to a life of poverty and simplicity. And it is at this point that God reveals himself unto Moses. And that's where we pick up in Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Now it says, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. And his father-in-law was a priest of Midian. Now, as Moses kept his flock, he led the flock to the backside of the desert. And he came unto the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he saw that the bush was burning, yet it was not being consumed. And this drew his interest. So he says in verse 3, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not being consumed by the fire. And when the Lord saw that Moses turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. When God calls us, friends, we are to respond with the same voice of surrender. Here am I, Lord. What is it that you ask of your servant? And he said to Moses, Before you draw nigh, take your shoes off of your feet, for the place wherein you stand is holy ground. And he said unto Moses, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Now God said, I've seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. I've heard their cry. I've heard their prayers. I know their sorrows. Friends, we must realize in the story here that the people of God had been praying for quite some time. I mean, they'd been in bondage for 400 years. And so certainly by this time, their prayer was an act of obedience. And I'm sure oftentimes they felt like their prayers were going unheard. Maybe even as you feel at times, your prayer is going unheard. But be assured, friends, He knows your suffering. He hears your prayers, and He has an appointed time when He will act on your behalf. And until that time comes, we are simply to wait on God, to remain faithful in obedience. Well, God continues in verse 8, and He says, I am come down to deliver them from the hand of the Egyptians. Now, at this point, Moses is probably saying, that's great. You're going to deliver them. Little does he know that God is going to use him in the deliverance of his people. And this won't be accepted as readily by Moses, as we will see. He says, I want to bring them up out of the land that they are now in bondage, and I want to bring them to a good land, a large land, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land which is now occupied by the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And so in order for the people of Israel to take this land, they're going to have to overcome these peoples and take these cities for themselves. And God says in verse 10, come now, therefore, Moses, I'm going to send you unto Pharaoh, and it is you that will bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now notice Moses' response in verse 11. He said unto God, who am I? I thought you were going to deliver them. I'm a small shepherd. I have no place before Pharaoh. Besides, you know that Pharaoh sought my life. My reputation is not good in Egypt. There is a death sentence there that awaits me. And God says in verse 12, do not fear, Moses. I will be with you. And this will be a token, a sign that I have sent thee. When you have brought them out of Egypt, you will serve God upon this very mountain. And so Moses, looking for an excuse, a way out, says, well, when I come unto the children of Israel, and I say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, they will ask me, what is your name? And I don't know you. I don't know what your name is. What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And so shall you say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. Now there is a lot of truth that is wrapped within this name. He's not I was, he's not I will be. He's ever constant, he's ever present, he is I am. And this is the same name that Jesus used in John chapter 8, verse 58, when the religious leaders asked him, as he was present among them that day, how he could see Abraham, who lived some 3,000, 4,000 years ago. And Jesus said, I am. When Abraham was, I am. And this is the same name that Jesus used, and that's why they took up stones to stone him. They knew that he was claiming to be the Almighty God walking in the flesh. Well, God says to Moses in verse 16, gather the elders of Israel together. You see, even at this time, even in a time of suffering and bondage, there are those among the children of Israel who were elders, who were teaching them, who were guiding them, who were instructing them in the way of the Most High. And they are encouraging the people to remain faithful in their time of suffering, standing upon the promise that God had made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that they will be a great and mighty nation. And God tells Moses to tell the people, to tell the elders, that he is aware of their suffering, and he will bring them out of the affliction of Egypt into the promised land, unto the land that is flowing with milk and honey. And you will take these elders with you before the king of Egypt, and you will say to him, the Lord God of the Hebrews has met with us. And we ask of you that you would let us go 3 days' journey into the wilderness that we can sacrifice to the Lord our God. But at this point, he will not let them go. Therefore, I will stretch out my hand and I will smite Egypt with all my wonders I will do in the midst of them. And after that, he will let you go. So Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, will not let the people go based upon what Moses says or even what Moses does. He will only let the people go based upon what the Almighty himself does, so that God receives the praise and the glory in this deliverance of his people. And he says, I will give you favor from all the Egyptians, so that when you leave, you will not leave empty-handed. But every woman shall borrow of her neighbor jewels of silver, jewels of gold, and raiment. And you will put these upon your sons and upon your daughters, and you will take everything from the Egyptians. You will spoil the Egyptians. Well, Moses, still looking for an excuse, says in chapter 4, verse 1, The children of Israel, they will not believe me. They will say, the Lord has not appeared unto thee. And so God said, Moses, what do you have in your hand? And Moses said, a rod. And he said, cast it on the ground. And as he did, it turned into a serpent. And the Lord then said unto Moses, stretch forth your hand. Take the serpent by the tail. And when Moses did, it became a rod again. And God said, this is what you will do in order that the people will believe. And the Lord said furthermore unto him, put your hand into your bosom. And he put his hand into his bosom. And when he took it out, his hand was leprous as snow. And God said, now put your hand into your bosom again. He put his hand into his bosom again. When he took it out, it was as normal as his other hand. And so God said, if they will not believe the first sign, certainly they will believe the second sign. And he says in verse 9, if they will not believe the first two signs, then you are to take water of the river, pour it upon dry land, and the water which you take out of the river will become blood upon the dry land. Now Moses, at this point, realizing that none of the excuses that he has offered is sufficient for the Lord to redirect his mission to someone else, Moses says in verse 10, I am not eloquent. I am not a good speaker. Certainly there must be someone better suited for this job. I am slow of speech and I am slow of tongue. And yet the Lord said unto him, who has made man's mouth? Who's made your mouth, Moses? Isn't it I who make the dumb or make the deaf? Isn't it I who make the seeing or the blind? If I made these things, can I not perfect them? And so I simply want you to go. I will be with your mouth. I will teach you what you shall say. You simply repeat what I say. Well, that's simple enough. Moses doesn't have to figure out what to say. He doesn't have to organize a great speech. He simply has to repeat what the Lord is going to say to him. And yet Moses says in verse 13, O my Lord, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him who thou wilt send. And at this point, the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. And it's as if the Lord says, fine, it is you that I have appointed to this mission, and you're going to go. But if you don't want to speak on my behalf, is not Aaron your brother, and cannot he speak well? He is even now coming to meet you. When you see him, he will be glad in his heart. And you will speak with him, and you will tell him all that I have told to you. And he will be your spokesman unto the people. I will speak to you, and you simply tell him what I have said. So to Aaron, you will be the mouth of God. And we're going to close there today, friends. But what we learn from this is that God has called and chosen us, each of us, for a very specific purpose. And no matter how insufficient we may think that we are, God can use us to do great and mighty things in his name and for his glory. Now, certainly, somewhere in the back of Moses' mind, he sees himself unworthy to be an agent of God. I mean, he's a murderer. How can God use a murderer for his glory? And yet that's the beauty of the story, friends, that God can use the worst of man. He even chooses the worst and the most foolish of us to do great things in his name. And so my question to you this morning is this. I don't know where you are in your life, but what is it that God has called you to do for his service, for his glory? Whatever it is, friends, no matter how simple or how grandiose in your mind, learn from Moses. Your excuses are not sufficient. If God has called you and chosen you for a specific task, you cannot argue your way out of it with God. You are simply to obey and trust, and then stand back and watch what glorious things that he can and will do through you for the purpose of his will and the purpose of his kingdom. Well, hallelujah, friends. I'm so grateful again that you're with us. And I trust that you are being both blessed and challenged in your daily commitment to your Lord as you seek to walk before Him with honor and faithfulness in each and every moment of your life. Well, I truly love you, friends. Now, as He wills, and until next time, I'll see you on the next video.